Morning, madam.
Good morning. Come, we'll start our case presentation today. Okay, now Lakshmi is going to present, right? Okay, fine.
Good morning, everyone. My patient, Mrs. A, 27-year-old, postgraduate, now a homemaker, hailing from Thrissur, married to Mr. B, 34-year-old graduate, now working as an accountant, belonging to middle socioeconomic class. She is a second gravida with one previous abortion, with her last menstrual period on 29th of December 2017, with her EDC on 5th of October 2018, with excellent dates, now at 38 weeks and 2 days of gestation. Her chief complaints: patient got admitted a month back with complaints of tiredness and easy fatigability, shortness of breath on exertion since 1 month, progressively increasing and aggravated since 2 weeks, and with intermittent lower abdominal pain since 2 days. History of presenting illness: patient was apparently all right 1 month prior to her admission, when she developed progressively increasing tiredness, easy fatigability, and shortness of breath on exertion, and was aggravated 2 weeks prior to her admission here. She also had complaints of progressive intermittent lower abdominal pain since 2 days. No history of any associated bleeding, leaking per vagina or discharge per vagina, backache or dysuria, and patient is appreciating fetal movements well. No history of palpitations, chest pain, syncope, chronic cough with expectoration, fever or weight loss. There's no history of passing worms and stools, constipation, melena, bleeding per rectum or hematurium. She gives no history of easy bruising, petechiae, bony pain, headache, increased menstrual blood loss during her prior cycles. History of present pregnancy.
So with this in mind, what are the things that you've thought of so far?
The patient actually came with complaints of progressively increasing breathlessness on exertion and easy fatigability, and with intermittent.
So that was her prime symptom, right?
Since okay. 2 weeks, aggravated since 2 weeks, and okay. with intermittent abdominal pain since 2 days.
Okay.
So what brought her was the pain, and
we'll forget about the pain. But what was her real problem?
Her real problem was her exertional breathlessness.
So what did you think of at that point of time?
Most commonly, it could be due to anemia, or it could be a cardiac disease.
Or it could be a
physiological symptom of pregnancy.
Let me tell you something. The physiological changes that take place in pregnancy never causes any symptoms. Mm. There's a very good adaptation as the pregnancy advances. So basically, you have thought of two things: either it could be an anemia, or whether it could be a cardiovascular
heart disease
problem. Okay, right. So what's the history of present illness? And the second problem you said was pain.
Pain.
So that was actually what brought it to you. And what did you think of at that point of time?
A preterm labor. Or it could be a urinary tract infection.
Or it could be some other cause for pain abdomen. Okay, fine.
History of present pregnancy. First trimester. It was a spontaneous conception 2 years after marriage. Pregnancy was detected by urine pregnancy test 5 days after missing her period.
Okay.
She had regular antenatal checkups, blood investigations and ultrasound were done at 8 weeks and were told to be normal.
So that 8 weeks ultrasound told us?
That her dates are...
That's a dating ultrasound. Scan, yeah. The ideal time to date would have been...
9 to 11 weeks.
9 to 11 weeks from the crown rump length.
Yeah.
Okay, that would have been ideal. But 8 weeks is fine. Okay, fine. Then...
she was started on folic acid.
So at 8 weeks, what would you have actually preferred for as a diameter for gestational age?
The mean sac. Allah.
Mean sac diameter. Okay. Right.
The patient was then started on folic acid tablets. She had not taken folic acid preconceptionally. Patient gives history of hyperemesis since conception, but no history of any hospital admissions for the same.
Okay.
A second ultrasound was done at 12 weeks and was told to be normal.
So that was probably
the NT scan for early anomalies,
14 weeks scan, which we do for an NT scan. So that was also done, right?
She gives no history of fever with rash, bleeding per vagina, dysuria, abdominal pain, or exposure to any other drugs or radiation.
Okay.
In first trimester.
The first trimester.
Second trimester, quickening was felt to 20 weeks. She gives history of persistent hyperemesis and decreased appetite. No history of any elevated BP, headache, bleeding per vagina, abdominal pain, dysuria.
Okay.
In the second trimester.
Okay.
Patient had regular antenatal checkups.
Yes.
Folic acid tablets were continued and patient was started on iron and calcium tablets. But she gives history of non-compliance to oral iron due to nausea.
Okay, fine.
An ultrasound was done at 20 weeks and was told to be normal.
Okay. So the 20 weeks ultrasound was, yes, Sharanya?
It's an anomaly scan.
Targeted imaging.
This is a targeted anomaly scan.
Targeted scan for anomalies, fetal anomalies, right? Okay. So that was also done. So she's had a scan for a gestational age. Second, she's had 11 earlier. To 14 weeks. Now she's had a targeted scan for fetal anomalies. Right. Fine.
A GCT was done in 26 weeks, which was found to be marginally raised. And a confirmatory test was done again, which was told to be normal.
Okay, fine.
Two doses of TT injection were taken at 24 and 28 weeks.
Fine.
She doesn't give any history of easy fatigability, shortness of breath in the second trimester.
Okay.
Third trimester, patient had regular antenatal checkups. She could take iron and calcium tablets regularly from the third trimester. An ultrasound was done at 34 weeks and was told to be normal. It was at 34 weeks that the patient started developing shortness of breath on exertion, tiredness, easy fatigability, which progressively increased and was aggravated since 2 weeks prior to her admission here.
Okay.
She also gives history of intermittent lower abdominal pain, progressively increasing in intensity and frequency since the last 2 days prior to admission.
So that was the lower abdominal.
Lower abdominal pain.
Okay, fine.
There was no history of any associated leaking or bleeding per vagina, discharge per vagina, backache, dysuria, or decreased fetal movements.
Very good. Very good. So basically, you have thought of
a preterm labor and its causes.
Preterm pain and probably urinary tract infections, etc. Because it's a lower abdominal pain, right?
She doesn't give any history of chest pain, syncope, cough with expectoration, fever, weight loss, melena. Easy bruising in the third.
Good, phase. Very good.
Menstrual history. Patient attained menarche at 12 years of age. She had regular cycles with 4 to 5 days of flow and 30 days duration. She doesn't give any history of heavy menstrual bleeding or dysmenorrhea during her prior menstrual cycle.
Very good.
Her last menstrual period was on 29th of December 2017. Marital and obstetric history. Patient is married since 2 years, was a non-consanguineous marriage. No history of any contraceptive use. She's a second gravida with one previous abortion. Her abortion was a year back, a spontaneous abortion at 12 weeks for which an evacuation was done.
Okay.
Past history. No history of diabetes mellitus, hypertension, tuberculosis, any chronic cardiac or renal disease, any bleeding disorder, malaria, or recurrent urinary tract infections in the past.
Okay.
No history of any previous surgeries, any exposure
so
to...
So what are the chronic ailments which can give rise to anemia?
A chronic kidney disease.
Yes.
Liver disease.
In fact, many chronic times in chronic renal failure, yeah. You will recognize that disease only by noticing the anemia in the patient. Okay, right. Then...
Tuberculosis,
yes.
Chronic liver disease.
Chronic liver diseases.
Malaria. Okay. Even worm infestations.
Worm infestations. Right. Okay. Yes.
Okay. No history of any prior blood transfusions. No history of any chronic drug intake.
These worm infestations which you said, what is the type of worm that can cause it?
Mainly
hookworms. And how do you acquire it?
Walking barefoot.
That is the problem with when you go barefoot. So being an educated girl like her, I'm sure she wouldn't have had that as a problem. So that's how they normally acquire hookworm infestation. Hookworm. And the types of hookworm that you normally see are?
Mainly two types, Enchylostoma duodenale and Nicator americanus.
Yes.
And
there are many other types of worms, but what really causes anemia is actually hookworm infestation. Okay, right. So and that is normally acquired through walking barefoot. And can you deworm them during pregnancy?
Yes.
After the first trimester, by the second trimester.
After the first trimester, and what are the drugs which you give?
You can give albendazole, 400 milligrams.
Or?
One tablet.
Albendazole, 100 milligrams.
Twice daily for three days.
That's, and you give it, as she said, after the
first trimester.
And in malaria, what do you give? From a malaria endemic area?
Chloroquine.
300 milligrams. Each tablet is 300 milligrams. You must take two tablets every week from the second and third trimester. Okay. So in malaria endemic areas, you do that. Okay. And those patients who have had tuberculosis, will you continue the anti-tuberculosis treatment?
Yes, madam.
We should continue the anti-tuberculosis treatment. Right.
Family history.
Yes.
Her father and mother are both diabetic, hypertensive, and dyslipidemic on treatment. No history of any tuberculosis, bleeding disorders, anemia, or any genetic disorders in the family.
Very good.
Personal history. Her sleep is normal. She consumes a mixed diet. She takes milk, fish and eggs, but not meat. Her bowel and bladder habits are regular, unaltered.
Yes.
Her dietary history. She consumes a mixed diet. Her daily calorie requirement is 2,500 kilocalories per day, and her intake is 2,000 kilocalories, which shows a deficiency of 500 kilocalories. And her daily protein requirement is 65 grams. Her intake amounts to 60 grams, which is adequate.
Okay. So now, Aishwari, you tell me what are the foodstuffs which are rich in iron?
Iron-rich foods are green leafy vegetables, dry fruits, dry nuts, meat, especially liver, then jaggery, then drumsticks, spinach,
gooseberries, dates. All that is very rich in iron. The dried fruits, especially apricots. All that is very rich in iron. Do you understand? So you'll have to educate the patient that they say that even cooking in iron utensils actually increases the iron. What are the other foodstuffs which you normally, for folic acid, what are the foodstuffs which you normally use?
Fresh vegetables and fruits, meat, organ meat, fresh leafy vegetables and fresh fruits.
They are very rich in folic acid. So you must always combine all this in your diet. And in vitamin B12?
It is mainly non-vegetarian diet, includes vitamin B12
is only seen in a non-vegetarian diet. That is why many times people who are on vegetarian diet may have to take supplementation. Okay, and how do you normally supplement B12?
It is parenteral.
Preferable to give parenteral form because the oral is not really well absorbed. And so how do you give the parenteral form?
1000 milligram weekly.
Yeah, you can give, if at all she is deficient in B12, we can give 1000 milligram weekly once, intramuscularly for about 6 to 8 weeks. You understand, right? And if you're giving folic acid, how much do you normally give?
Normally we give, according to Indian, it is 500 microgram.
See, normally we say 400 microgram is enough, but there are no tablets which is 400. So normally we give the 5 milligram folic acid tablets. Okay, right. So this is how normally we supplement if at all this is required. So the dietic requirement of all these supplements, the micro and the macronutrients are very important for preventing nutritional anemia. Right. Okay, then.
Examination.
Yes.
Patient is comfortable.
Yes.
She's moderately built and nourished.
Yes.
Her height is 152 centimeters.
Yes.
Her pre-pregnancy weight was 49 kg. Her present weight is 59 kg. A weight gain of 10 kilograms.
Yes.
Her pre-pregnancy BMI was 21.2 kilogram per meter square.
Okay.
Pallor is present. There's no evidence of angular stomatitis.
So where do you look out for pallor?
In the lower back.
Julia, you answer.
We look in the non-melanocytic areas.
Talk clearly.
Like non-palpebral, lower palpebral conjunctiva.
Yes.
In the palmar crease, yes. Nail beds and tongue.
oral mucosa, right? Oral mucosa. And the PAMA creases are very important.
It shows a severe degree of anemia
when you've got even the PAMA crease involved. Other place which you can look at is the vagina. So many times I identify it when I look at her, when I do a vaginal examination, when you find that the vagina is also very pale, it tells you that she must be really pale. Do you understand? Right. Then, what else did you look at?
No evidence of angular stomatitis, glossitis or chelitis.
Why did she do that, Julia? Talk into the mic.
In vitamin B12 deficiency, you get glossitis. That is flattening of the tongue papillae.
Flattening of the tongue papillae, B12, yes.
Then glossitis. Angular stomatitis, we get an iron deficiency.
Yeah. Fissures in the angle of the mouth.
Okay.
Glossitis, keloses. All this we normally see. Then what are the other things that you looked at in the general examination?
There was no icterus, cyanosis.
Why icterus?
Hemolytic anemia.
Hemolytic anemia. Right. Then?
Cyanosis, clubbing, lymphadenopathy or raised
tubular. Why lymphadenopathy?
In tuberculosis.
Mostly this age group, we don't see malignancies. It must be tuberculosis. Right. Then, what else did you look at?
Raised jugular venous pulsation.
That is because?
Cardiac diseases.
So when you find that, whether it be a cardiac disease or an anemia with failure, you will find there's a raised JVP, right? Okay, then.
There was bilateral pitting pedal edema till just above the ankles.
Yes. And how do you check out for pedal edema? Focus on the patient.
Pedal edema is checked out at the bony prominence. We look at the medial malleoli and then you press your finger against the bony prominence.
Against the shin. Actually, the medial malleolus is only to guide you. Do you understand?
Yes, ma'am.
Actually, we take a flat bone and so that part is the shin. Mm-hmm. Okay?
And so then you press against it so that demonstrates and press it for around 10 seconds or more.
30 seconds or so. And then you will find that you have displaced the fluid. So that tells you it is a
pitting edema.
When do you get a non-pitting edema?
In filariasis, even
in mixed edemas. Do you understand? In those conditions, you may get
a non-pitting edema,
right?
And then so bilaterality is also.
What are the other things that you look at, Lakshmi? About the
extent
edema.
Of the edema.
Yes.
Whether it's up below the knees or above the knees or for abdominal.
So you tell
edema.
About the level of edema, right? Okay. If I ask you what are the pathological sites of edema?
Non-dependent areas like face, abdominal wall, face.
Wait, one person at a time. Yes, Aishwarya?
Face, abdomen,
finger rings,
and vulval edema. Okay. Yeah. In a dependent, that is a person who is walking, dependent edema is on the legs. But a person who has been in bed rest, the dependent area is over the
sacrum.
Do you understand? Right. Okay. So basically, she's got bilateral pedal edema just above the ankles. Okay, fine. Then,
skin and hair appear normal.
Yes, skin. We said we look out for
any dryness. Skin.
Dryness. Any skin lesions. It could be ichthyosis. Mm-hmm. It could be some other mal. Yes,
petechial
hemorrhages to see whether she's got any bleeding tendencies. Petechial hemorrhages, ecchymosis. Do you understand? Right. Then.
No evidence of any leg ulcers or petechiae.
Yes, and leg ulcers is for?
Sickle cell disease,
okay. And sickle cell is more rampant when?
In our area, hilly areas.
Among the tribal folks, the Adivasis of Wayanad, they are very thing. They say even the black Americans, they have got high incidence of sickle cell disease, right? And thalassemia, I said, was?
Asian population,
right? So we'll have to see the background, the ethnic background is also important for us to name whether she's got that particular type of anemia, right? Then what else?
Her nails are thin, brittle and pigmented.
What are the stages in which you can get, Tina? Stages in which you can get brittleness?
First stage is thin, brittle, dry and brittle nails.
Second stage is
flattening out.
And third stage is spoon-shaped or coilonychia, right. which you get in iron deficiency anemia. Right. Then?
No evidence of any frontal bossing, bony tenderness.
Frontal bossing was for?
Thalassemia.
Yes. That bony is called tenderness. The thalassemia facies. Right. Okay. Then?
Bony tenderness, prominence of maxilla.
Yes.
Or facial puffiness.
Puffiness. Okay.
thyroid, breast, spine, and
so weight. Actually what you really mean by maxillary prominence and frontal bursing is you've got
blood dysplasia.
Yeah, blood dysplasia. And so what happens?
Bone
marrow expansion. Do you understand? Due to excessive erythropoiesis. Yes.
Thyroid, breast, spine, and gait normal. Patient is afebrile. Pulse rate of 100 beats per minute. Good volume, regular rhythm. Her blood pressure is 120 by 80 millimeters of mercury.
Yes.
In the right arm, supine position.
Yes. Is it important for you to check the blood pressure in a patient like this?
Yes, madam, because her symptoms, she came with breathing difficulty and all that. So
but more than that,
in such patients, they are. Patients are prone for hypertensive disorders, preeclampsia.
The ones in anemia are more prone to develop hypertensive disorders. Preeclampsia is very common in them, especially in the dimorphic variety. Yeah. Do you understand? Right. Yes.
Respiratory rate of 16 breaths per minute. Systemic examination. Cardiovascular system, S1, S2 heard, no murmurs. Respiratory system, normal vesicular.
Where do you look out for a hemic murmur?
Aortic
area, you look out for a soft blowing murmur, right? Okay. Yes.
Respiratory system, normal vesicular breath sounds heard, bilaterally equal air entry, no basal crepitations, no added sounds.
Okay, fine. So basal creps are basically to look out for early evidence of failure. Okay, right.
Central nervous system, there was no gross neurological deficit.
Why did you look out for that?
In vitamin B12 deficiency, it can lead to a subacute combined degeneration of the spinal cord.
Or demyelination. Okay, so it's very important that you have to check out for the CNS also, right? Then?
Obstetric examination.
Yes.
On inspection.
Yes. Can we have the... Yeah, Tina, just show us.
While we are going to do an obstetric examination, always we'll have to ask the patient to empty her bladder to begin with.
So you've got to make sure that the bladder is empty. Okay.
Then you will have to get the consent of the patient, build a rapport with her, and tell her what's going
to
be done.
No, you tell us what you're going to do. You don't have to. You show it to us.
Then. Put a sheet above her so that she is covered well and she is comfortable.
Yes.
Then expose her from the...
Adequate exposure, okay.
From the cypher sternum upwards to the pubic symphysis is exposed and the flank should also be exposed well.
So from the cypher sternum to the pubic symphysis...
With her hands by the sides. The flank should be well exposed.
Okay. Then what else? How do you position the patient?
Patient has to be in a prone position. Flexed and semi-abducted.
So this is basically the position in which you have to examine the patient. So the flanks are free.
Yeah.
You understand? Now tell us, Lakshmi, what you see, and then Tina will show us.
On inspection.
Yes.
Abdomen is longitudinally distended. Linea nigra and striae gravidarum seen.
Yes.
Umbilicus is central, flushed with skin.
Yes.
No dilated veins, scars or sinuses.
Yes.
Hernial orifices appear normal.
Yes.
On palpation.
Yes.
Fundal height corresponds to 38 weeks, that is 34 weeks with flanks full.
Yeah, one minute. Now Tina will show us. Show us the fundal height. How do you examine the fundal height?
While we are going to do the fundal height, you will have to always correct
the let me reiterate. Yeah. The consent was important. The bladder being empty was important. The positioning of the patient is important. And the patient being adequately exposed is important.
And then you will have to stabilize the uterus. That is, the uterus might be dextrorotated.
Rather than stabilize, the word is centralized. Centralize the uterus. Yes.
So now this appears to have a tilt to the right. So I'm centralizing it by giving.
So what are the two conditions in which you centralize the uterus, Aishwarya?
One is to find the fundal height, then symphysio fundal height.
So for symphysio fundal height and to know the weeks of gestation, we'll have to correct the dextrorotation. After that, you do not have to correct the dextrorotation. Right. Then?
So then I'm centralizing it. And from the cypher sternum downwards, I'm gently palpating with the ulna border of my hand, and the first resistance that I encounter is where the fundus of the uterus is, and it it is here that I'm getting
yeah,
it.
The word I want to use it is very gentle palpation.
And so I got the first resistance here and I marked that point. So this is my fundal height. This corresponds to 34 weeks exactly.
What should you have got ready when you did that?
I should have my tape with
tape
me.
Tape ready with you.
And then from here, for myself not to be biased, I keep the inside up and mark my point there. From here on, mulu kaalana thaalthi vekka. To measure this, I'll have to put the legs down.
Very good.
And then I measure it up to the pubic symphysis. Stretched out at the center.
Kirti, in weeks of gestation, how does it correspond to?
From 18 to 32 weeks, the symphysia fundal height in centimeters corresponds to week of gestation.
Weeks of gestation. So beyond that, does it mean that you will not check?
No. You have to so that
you have to check, but it is a
only a measure.
Yeah, it is an objective way of measuring a patient. But just to say that between 18 and 32 weeks, that
it corresponds.
And at full term, where is it actually?
It is at 32 weeks with flanks full.
Now, Lakshmi, how many weeks is she?
She's 38.
Now, 38 weeks.
I got a fundal height of 34 weeks and flanks
are full.
Again, corresponding.
Corresponding. Yeah. So, in this patient, it corresponds
to the period of gestation.
Now, what will you do back again? The legs.
I'll have to put back the legs.
Now, the legs go back into its original position of semi-flexion and abduction. Okay, for the rest of the examination. So, only when you want to check the symphysio fundal height, you have to
do ask her to
straighten. Then,
fundal grip. This is soft, broad, non-bellotable mass. Suggestive of breech.
Okay.
While doing the fundal grip, I use the palmar aspect of my hand and never with the fingers.
No, not the fingertips.
Tips.
That is important. Yeah. You require the palmar aspect of your the fingers as well as the palm. The whole hand should be there, okay? But we don't do with your tips.
Yeah.
I remember an examiner telling me that if she takes her tips to examine, then I immediately write F. Do you understand? So it is so important that you examine the patient, the palmar aspect of your hand. Yes.
Going from the to the fundus.
Flat with the flat of your hand. That's a correct word.
I palpate the fundus and I look out for what the part is, the part of the baby that is occupying the fundus. Now I'm getting a broad mass which is
stand
soft
straight
and it is not bellotable.
So it's a non-bellotable broad soft mass which is at the fundus. Now you can say it is at the fundus or it could be at the right hypochondrium or in the left hypochondrium, wherever. But you've got to say where it is. What's
so
the next grip?
This is a breech.
Lateral grips. This is smooth curved resistance on the right side, suggestive of back.
Yeah, tell us, Tina.
Again, when I go for the lateral grips, I'll have to see, she said the right first. So I'm centralizing the steadying the uterus from this side and feeling.
So the opposite hand just steadies the uterus. That's all it does. The palmar aspect of your hand.
And I'm feeling for the part that is occupying the lateral aspect.
So what are you actually looking
right
at?
Right now I'm feeling a.
You're looking at the curved uniform resistance of the back.
So now I'm getting it a curved uniform resistance.
So where have you got it? Is it important to tell us where it is?
Yes, madam. This comes more anterior.
So if it is more anterior, possibly your position must be?
A right occipito anterior.
Right occipito anterior. If you get the back, the same resistance posteriorly, it must be
it might be a right occipito posterior.
Because the back leads to the occiput. And so you believe that with the position of the back to a certain extent, you can make out from your lateral grip, the position of the baby to a certain extent, right? Then?
Irregular knob-like structures on the left, suggestive of limb buds.
So again, I'm doing this, pushing it this side and then through here, I'm getting knob-like structures here. So that is a limb buds.
Limb buds.
Yeah.
Yes. No, kidu vena. Idu pukanchu. Limb buds. Then what is it that you do?
First pelvic rib. There is a round, hard, bellotable mass, suggestive of head.
And Tina, how do you do the first pelvic grip?
For the first pelvic grip, I'll take my thumb aside and the other four fingers apart. Open out your hand and place the ulna border onto the pubic symphysis. And then feel what part is occupying the lower pole.
Very good. So how did you do that?
Keeping it like this.
And where do you look, Tina?
I look at the patient.
Look at the patient's
and
face because you should not be hurting the patient. Okay?
Now I'm getting a hard mass. It's mobile and it's bellotable.
Fine. Yeah. So you should not hurt the patient, and you should do it. What else will you do in that first pelvic grip?
How many fifths?
How many fifths
are palpable?
So right in this patient,
I could get
keep don't cup your hand. Flatten it out.
Yeah, I can get all five. So it's all five. By
so it is 5 by 5. So after the first pelvic grip, you say what occupies it, and if it is the head, you'll have to say whether it is 5 by 5. Okay. Right. Next.
Second pelvic grip.
So what do you have to do
for the second pelvic grip? So far, I was facing the patient. Now I'll have to face the foot end of the patient, and then for the second pelvic grip, again I'll use both my hands, and I'll be coming just above the presenting part.
Yeah. If you want, you can also straighten. You can also.
I'll have to straighten the legs, ma'am.
Yes. Yes. Tell us.
Go on.
Tell us how you do it,
madam. Then the ulna border of my hand would be almost parallel to the inguinal ligament, and what I'm trying to feel is whether I confirm my findings of the first pelvic grip. So I'm getting again a hard mass, which is the head.
Yes.
And then I try to see the attitude of the head, being a head.
What do you mean by attitude?
The relation
relationship between the occiput and the sinciput. Okay. Now, can I ask you, can anybody tell me in this, what is the cephalic prominence?
The first prominence on palpation of the side of the back.
No. It is the first prominence that you encounter when you come from above down. Okay. And in a vertex presentation, it is the sinciput, and it is on the opposite side of the
back.
And in an extended head, it is
the
occiput and on the same side of the back. Let me ask you then, in occiput or posterior, how is it? There is no cephalic prominence. It is an attitude in which the sinciput and the occiput are at the same level. Okay. That is the position, right?
Then, madam, again,
so that will also tell you to a certain extent whether the position of the baby's head is flexed or extended. Right?
Now, again, with the second pelvic grip.
So, coming back to our second pelvic grip, you will know the findings of the first pelvic grip.
I can find out the attitude of the head, and then
whether it's engaged, whether it's gone in or not.
You use only three words. We use whether the head is mobile,
unengaged,
or whether it is engaged. Okay, those are the. And so in this case, what has happened?
So now, if I'm able to converge my fingers,
if you're able to converge your fingers, that means you've gone below the head, and so that means head is mobile. Okay, right. Then what else will you check out?
Auscultation.
Prior to that, madam, all the while when I was palpating, the uterus had been relaxed, and I feel on the lateral grip I could get a good feel of the lica. So
She's got adequate lica. Very good. Then,
on auscultation, fetal heart sounds were heard on the right spinoumbilical line.
Yes.
More on the medial side.
Yeah. So if it is an occiput to anterior, you will get the spinoumbilical where the lateral. The two-thirds meets the medial one-third. Mm-hmm. If it is occiput to posterior, where the medial two-thirds meets the lateral one-third. So you'll get somewhere there, way out in the flank in an occiput to posterior. So you got it more anteriorly, right? So this patient must be having a right occiput to
anterior,
right? Okay, right. Then, what is the fetal heart?
The rate.
Yeah, the rate is 140. It is regular. And heard in the right spinoumbilical line. Then anything else want to tell us?
No evidence of any hepatosplenomegaly.
No. I am not done with the. What else will you tell us? Will you tell us whether the uterus is relaxed?
Yeah.
Relaxed. Adequate. Will you tell us the clinical estimate of the fetal weight? Yes.
Around
how much?
2.5.
Is it time for us to estimate the fetal weight?
Yes, ma'am. She's 38 weeks.
And so it is time for us to tell us the estimated weight. So what do you think the clinical weight is?
Around
2.5. And when do you use the, Aishwarya, when do you say the Johnson's formula?
At term.
When it's a cephalic presentation. Okay, only then. You cannot use it for a preterm. You cannot use it for a non-cephalic presentation also, right? So, this, and Johnson's formula always tends to overestimate. So, better than that is your clinical estimate, and you can approximate. So, what do you think the weight of the baby is?
2.5 to 2.8.
It's even more. This must be about 2.8.
Yeah.
2.8 clinically. Okay. Then Tina, what will you do next?
I thank the patient. Oh, thank you. And make her comfortable.
Right. Thank you. Right. Yeah, now we'll continue with our discussion. Then what is the next thing that you would like to do, Lakshmi?
A pervaginal examination.
Why did you want to do a pervaginal?
She actually presented with complaints of intermittent lower abdominal pain. And now she's at term 38 weeks and 2 days. So to assess the
cervix. So it is time for us, any time after 38 weeks, now she's almost like a primate to us. Mm. So it is time for us to do a PV for
to assess the pelvic assessment.
We do a cervical assessment also in this patient because
she came with pain.
So there are two things that you can assess, the cervical assessment as well as the pelvic assessment in a patient like this. And then we assess for
Bishop's code when we are planning.
That is if you are going to induce the patient. But when do I check for CPD?
Only when
the patient is in active labor. And for me to diagnose a CPD and say that she's got no CPD or has got CPD, then I must see that the membranes have also been ruptured before I make a commitment like that. Have you understood?
Yes,
right. So coming back, what's your diagnosis?
Summarizing.
Yes, summary.
Mrs. A, 27-year-old, second gravida,
yes,
with one previous abortion.
Yes.
Now at 38 weeks and 2 days of gestation.
Yes.
Got admitted at 34 weeks with complaints of easy fatigability, exertional shortness of breath since 1 month, aggravated since 2 weeks.
Yes.
And intermittent lower abdominal pain since 2 days.
Yes.
She gives history of hyperemesis.
Yes.
Throughout the first and second trimester, with poor compliance to oral iron.
Yes.
No significant findings in history except for a deficient caloric intake of 500 kilocalories per day.
Yes.
No other positive findings in history.
And general examination?
Pallor present, bilateral pitting pedal edema present, and thin brittle pigmented nails.
Yes.
Sure. There's also tachycardia, 100 beats per minute.
Very good.
Systemic examination with the normal limits.
And the BP was normal.
Is it important
for you to say that it is normal?
Yes, yes.
Then?
With a single live fetus in longitudinal live cephalic presentation corresponding to 38 weeks of gestation.
Yes.
With a relaxed uterus.
Yes. Your diagnosis is?
Diagnosis, a 27-year-old, second gravida with one previous abortion at 38 weeks and 2 days with nutritional anemia, probably iron deficiency, and admitted with complaints of preterm labor.
Very good. So she has completed the diagnosis because the patient also came with pain abdomen.
Yeah.
Is it very common to see preterm pain?
Yes. Yes.
What are the normal problems, Sharinya? What are the normal problems you encounter in a patient who's got a nutritional anemia?
First one is preterm labor.
First is preterm labor.
She can have
from the first trimester, what all can you get?
She can get a miscarriage.
Preterm labor.
Susceptibility to infections. Postpartum.
What infections?
Recurrent uterine tract infections.
Yes.
Thromboembolism.
Thromboembolic manifestations, yes.
Gestational hypertension.
Yes, Aishwarya.
Gestational hypertension.
Yes.
She is more prone for IUGR.
She is prone for growth restricted FGRs.
Intrauterine demise.
Fetal demise.
Then postpartum hemorrhage.
It is more plus she can't tolerate it. Then what are the other problems?
Puerperal sepsis.
Then
she is more prone for thromboembolic manifestations
in the postpartum period.
Sub-involution of the uterus.
Lactation failure. So these are all the problems which this patient can supposedly have. Okay, but this depends upon the severity of anemia. Now, basically, when you want to manage a patient, especially a nutritional anemia, what are the first thing you want to know? The type of anemia, right? Secondly, you want to know the severity of anemia. And third, you want to know the cause for the anemia. That is the main thing. Those are the three things we have to do investigations to find out. Now, I'm asking you, by definition, what do you mean by anemia?
It's a decrease in the oxygen carrying capacity of blood. Due to a fall in the hemoglobin. According to WHO, it's defined as a hemoglobin of less than 11 gram per deciliter.
Yes.
10 gram per deciliter for the developing world.
Yes.
According to ICMR.
What do you think FOXI has given a cutoff? 10. Foxy is going to cut off of 10. Because the more the limit that you put, then we'll be almost 100% Indians will be anemic. Do you understand? So we have taken a cut off of, in spite 10. Of that, what is our incidence?
Around 80%
to 90%.
Okay, then.
According to ICMR, it can be mild, moderate, severe and very severe.
Very severe. 10. So we'll go by that. Okay.
10 to 11 is a mild form. 7 to 10, moderate. 4 to 7, severe. And less than 4 is very severe.
Very severe. Okay. And we are most of the time we are concerned about the very severe and the severe. Okay. Most of us will be having a certain amount of mild. Too. I'll say almost everybody would have. But a moderate form, most of them would have. And this also probably falls under the moderate category. Okay. Right. So now when you see this, what are the investigations you will do for a patient like this?
First, for the evaluation of the anemia.
Yes.
We can ask for a hemoglobin with a hematocrit.
So basically you want to know the level of, that is the mark to tell you. Yes, then?
Hemoglobin with hematocrit.
Why do you want the hematocrit?
Basically for confirmation of the hemoglobin levels.
Why did you say confirmation? Yes, talking to you.
It's a double check on the hemoglobin.
It's a double check meaning always
three times
the hematocrit is three times the hemoglobin. And for all your derived, your hematological values, indices, it's derived from the RBC. So we get the hematocrit then.
We can ask for a peripheral smear.
We ask for a peripheral smear and we ask
complete hemogram.
Complete hemogram or the red cell indices. Red cell indices, right? So these are the four most important investigations in the same order as she has said. Now what can you make out from a peripheral smear?
The morphological indices of the RBC, that's the main corpuscular volume. Main corpus, yes. MCH, main corpuscular hemoglobin,
yes.
MCHC.
I'm just asking you at this point of time, you've got MCV, MCH, MCHC, which is the first to go down in an IDA?
MCV.
MCV is the first to go down, okay, right. So what is the normal MCV?
85 to 90.
Yeah, so it's around 88 cubic microns, right, then?
MCH around 32.
Yeah, 30 or so. Just keep one value. We don't remember more than a value. So we keep a range. So keep it around 30. Yes.
MCHC.
30 picograms. Okay. And MCHC is?
30 to 36.
33. See, keep about 33 as MCHC percent. Okay. Right. Then what is the peripheral smear? Tell me, Kirti, what all can you make out from a peripheral smear?
Anisocytosis.
No. First. First, we look at the
micros.
We look at the morphology first before we look at the size and shape. So, morphology will tell you about
microcytic hypochromic.
Whether it is microcytic hypochromic or whether it is macrocytic hyperchromic or whether it is macrocytic normochromic, everything it will tell you, right? So, no, morphology is very important. I'm just asking you at this point of time. Now, this patient probably we think is an IDA. So the other differential diagnosis for this would be?
Thalassemia.
Thalassemia could be a microcytic hyperchromic. Then?
Then sideroblastic anemia.
Sideroblastic anemia.
Chronic.
Any chronic infections, you can get the same microcytic hyperchromic.
Lead poisoning.
So in all these, are the conditions which we can normally get. But our closest bet would be with the
thalassemia.
Especially in our population, we do see patients with thalassemia, right? So now where you said thalassemia, now what else can you make out from a peripheral smear? Hypochromic, microcytic, then? You said anisocytosis. It tells us about the
size
of the RBCs.
Poikilocytosis
is the shape of the, one percentile, shape of the RBCs. So then what else can you make out? Yes, Aishwarya?
Any other... that is abnormalities of the RBCs, like sickling of the...
You can make out a sickling, you can make out sickle cells. You can get spherocytes of the RBCs, yes.
Schistocytes in case of schistocytes.
You can look out for evidence of hemolysis like
schistocytes,
burr cells, echinocytes, right. Okay, then. So evidence of hemolysis can be made out from looking at a peripheral smear, then.
Hypersegmented neutrophils.
Hypersegmented nuclease, when do you get it?
In vitamin B12.
In vitamin B12 folic acid. Megaloblastic anemia, you get hypersegmented more than five lobes, then? Anything else?
Parasites.
Pardon me? You can make out parasites like malaria parasites, then?
then other about platelets.
You can basically look generally at all the WBCs. You can look at generally at all the platelets. So general, you cannot say birth, but you can say certain amount that the platelets are adequate, etc. So a lot of information you can get from a good peripheral smear. So that should be one of your first investigations. So these four investigations you must see: the hemoglobin, the hematocrit, the red cell indices, and the peripheral smear. Now, supposing now she said, Kirti was telling us about it could be a thalassemia. Now, when I've got a doubt like that, you know, supposing a patient, now we have had instances in which we've been treating the patients after one pregnancy, after second pregnancy, every time they come back with us with a low hemoglobin, when we have never bothered to find out why is the hemoglobin always low. In such an instance, maybe we are dealing with a thalassemia trait. It would be a trait. Because the major thalassemia, which is called the Cooley's anemia or the Mediterranean anemia, we normally don't see in pregnancy because it is so severe and they die early also, right? So we see only the trait. So in such an event, what are the investigations you would have checked out?
We should check out serum ferritin.
So now I'm asking you, Aishwarya, in which order does the things disappear in an anemic patient?
First, serum ferritin.
So whenever there is a hemoglobin deficiency and when there's an anemia, the first thing that you see is a fall in?
Fall in serum ferritin.
Ferritin levels. Normal ferritin values are around?
Ferritin is 15 to 150 microgram per deciliter.
Correct. It is up to about 155. You can get nanograms per ml. But what you normally see is that in these patients, if it is less than 20, we see depleted iron stores. And if it is less than 12, we see absolutely no stores. So it depends upon, so we take 20 as a cutoff. 12th though, they have no iron stores at all. That means it must be a very severe degree of anemia, right? The second tier of the investigations which will go away when the patient has got iron deficiency
serum
is?
Serum iron will go down. Then serum percentage saturation.
The percentage saturation will go down. Transferring. Two things will go down. And what will go up?
Is total iron binding
the
capacity.
The iron binding capacity and the free protoporphyrin. Okay. Now I'm asking, what is the normal serum iron?
60 to 120 microgram per deciliter.
Yeah. So you get about 60 to 120 microgram per deciliter, right? That is a normal serum iron. It will go less than 60 if it is low.
Then iron deficiency anemia.
Then
other indices will be reduced only in the third stage.
No, when, what is your transferrin? What is your percentage saturation of transferrin?
25 to 60.
It's about 25 to 60%. And you will find less than 25% tells you that she must be having an iron deficiency anemia. So the serum iron will go down, the percentage saturation will go down, and the binding capacity is
will go up.
What is the normal value?
It's 200 to 360.
200 to 360 micrograms per deciliter, and you will find that it will go up. Maybe 400, 450. Binding capacity is going up, and the free protoporphyrin value 35. Is
up to 35,
35 micrograms per deciliter, and you'll find the value will go up. Yeah. So that is the next tier of investigations which you will actually have. So only in the third stage you see clinical anemia, and in the clinical anemia you'll find the hemoglobin has dropped,
hematocrit
has lowered, and the red cell indices have also gone down. Do you understand? And then you find the typical hyperchromic microcytic anemia. So by the time you see that, you don't have to go and check things which have gone down much earlier. So that is why I said limit your investigations to hemoglobin, hematocrit, peripheral smear and red cell indices. But when in doubt, supposing I think like what Kirti said, it could be a thalassemia, then I would ask for more investigations like I'll ask for serum ferritin, which will be normal in thalassemia. What are the other investigations which will be normal in thalassemia?
Red cell distribution width will be normal.
Yes.
Ferritin will be normal.
The ferritin will be normal.
Then
the free protoporphyrin will be normal. Yes.
Then
MCHC will be normal.
MCHC will be normal. All these will be normal in a patient who's got thalassemia. So if you've got a doubt, it will be able to pick up that very fast. So in case you've got a doubt, you have to go and ask for these investigations. Now the second tier of investigations is asked only when you require it. So what are they? Tell us now. The serum iron, ferritin, the iron.
Percentage saturation,
the iron binding capacity, the free protoporphyrin, the red cell distribution width, and on a very important and a very sensitive investigation is something which is called the transferrin receptor levels. It is a very, very sensitive. It tells you at the cellular level the iron values. In fact, it is one of the first to go up. It goes up. The transferrin receptor status goes up. The normal value is around
5.3
milligrams per liter. And you will find that goes up even before the volume, the mean corpuscular volume goes down. You will find that this will go up. Do you understand? So it's a very, very, so that is the next tier of investigations if required, you ask. Still you've got a doubt, has she got something else, she's not improving, then maybe you might think of megaloblastic anemia, then you will ask for, yes, Aishwarya?
B12 level.
You can ask for serum B12 levels.
Folate levels.
Folate levels and the folate level both in the serum and in the RBCs you can ask for, okay? Now supposing you think it is a hemolytic anemia, then what will you ask for?
Serum bilirubin levels
because you'll find the indirect bilirubin will be raised and you'll find the direct Coombs test is also raised. Do you understand? Right. Then if you think it is, supposing you think it is one of the hemoglobinopathies, you'll ask for hemoglobin
electrophoresis.
You'll have to ask for the electrophoresis. What are the various types of hemoglobin that you see, Kirti?
Adult hemoglobin.
Contains?
Normal alpha 2 and beta.
Two alpha chains and two beta chains. The A2 contains?
Two alpha chains and two delta chains.
The fetal hemoglobin is?
Alpha 2 and gamma 2.
So you like by electrophoresis you will know what is it? Is it adult hemoglobin? Is it A2? Is it the BARTS? Or do you think it is the fetal hemoglobin? You'll be able to make out and with that you'll be able to put 2 and 2 together and come to a diagnosis of a hemoglobinopathy. Supposing it is a glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase deficiency causing the anemia, you will ask for the screening for glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase. Okay, and if it is a congenital spherocytosis?
Osmotic fragility.
RBC osmotic fragility test you will ask for. So you don't have to ask for all these investigations. This is all very theoretical, but when in the scenario in which you have got a case at the exam and that case warrants these investigations, supposing it's a sickle cell, I'll ask for electrophoresis as a topper. It'll go up in my list of investigations. You understand? So that's how you always ask. Now, supposing you've come to a diagnosis of IDA, Tina, what is the advice that you give the patient?
Iron deficiency anemia can be corrected by nutritional supplementation.
Yes, what is the normal requirements during pregnancy, we said?
They require around 4 to 6 milligrams.
Yeah, in the second trimester they require about 4 to 6 milligrams, and in the third trimester they require about 6 to 8 milligrams. But normally we have only about 2 to 3 milligrams. The reason being because whatever we consume, only about 10% gets absorbed. So with 15 milligrams that we consume, only about 1.5. So we have not met with the demands of iron in pregnancy. That is how they always manifest with an iron deficiency anemia in pregnancy.
Since it's not made up by nutritional uptake, so we supplement her with oral iron.
Yes.
So and
what are the oral irons available? Can you tell us, Aishwarya?
Ferrous sulfate. Ferrous fumarate.
Yes, those are the two top in the list because they contain 60, how much of elemental iron?
65 milligrams
of elemental iron, the cheapest, the best iron. What they get in all the PHCs, etc., that is iron the best iron. And where is iron normally absorbed?
Duodenum and upper GI.
Can you tell me the absorption of iron?
Iron, what we take is basically contain ferric and it is converted to.
No. We always take in the ferrous form and after it gets absorbed in the ferrous form, it gets converted to ferric form and part of the ferric combines with apoferritin to form ferritin. And it is taken to the stores and the rest of it will combine with transferrin to circulate in the plasma. Mm-hmm. Do you understand? How is iron distributed in the body? How much of iron goes to the hemoglobin?
70%?
Yeah, 65 to 70% of your iron which you are taking goes to the hemoglobin expansion. Then what is the next chunk?
Liver.
20 to 25 goes to the stores.
Liver and spleen.
Yeah. Then you will find about 5 to 10% goes to the myoglobin and enzymes. And what is circulating in the plasma is only about 0.1 to 0.2%. So what is circulating so little? Do you understand? So 65 to 70% goes to the hemoglobin, right? Now that we know that she is giving iron, you are given the ferrous fumarate for the ferrous oxide. There are other irons which you are given.
Ascorbate,
gluconate,
succinate,
gluconate, which contains only about 35 milligrams, which contains 100 milligrams of elemental iron.
Ascorbate
and polymer.
Ascorbate is very good. Okay, as the name says, it has got ascorbic acid also, ascorbate is there, then
polymaltose,
iron polymaltose complex, and carbonyl ion, which contains 100%. So otherwise, what you can do is you can give the other iron forms twice or thrice a day. Okay. Have you understood? So that is how we normally give the iron. And what are the things which retard iron absorption?
That is antacids.
Acidity is the best way to absorb the iron. So antacids are detrimental. Yeah. So that is why we always ask them to take the iron
in an empty stomach,
right? Okay, when you cannot take oral iron, what is the next thing which you can give?
Parenteral iron.
Parenteral iron available modules are?
One is
iron dextran
or inferon, which is given in, intramuscularly. Yes. Only we need to give a test dose for that.
Yeah, but actually iron dextran is now gone down the scale. We prefer the IV preps.
That is
so iron dextran is one, and iron jectofer, that is iron sorbitol citric acid complex. That is another one which you can give intramuscularly. But today we prefer to give the IV
iron
forms.
Sucrose.
So IV, how do you give the test dose?
IV. Ma'am, 200.
The first part of the injection, which is given slowly, you can take it out, dilute it to the blood, and give that also slowly. That itself is a test dose. Do you understand? And then how do you normally calculate the total iron requirement?
That is the hemoglobin deficit.
Hemoglobin
deficit into body weight.
Body weight in kilograms
into 2.21
into plus 1,000 for the stores. So we calculate the total requirement. What's the best iron to give, Lakshmi?
Iron sucrose.
Sucrose is the best way. What is the advantage of iron sucrose?
It doesn't cause anaphylaxis.
No test dose required, no allergic manifestations. How much do you give?
We can give 200 milligrams in 20 ml of normal saline.
Yes.
Over 20 minutes
can be given slowly, right?
Up to 600 milligrams per week.
So you calculate the total dose. If it is 1800, it will take about 3 weeks for you to correct the deficiency with the IV. And what is the next thing which you can give?
Ferric carboxymaltose.
It is actually advocated for postpartum anemia, but they have been trying it in antenatal period also. And how do you give it?
Can be given IV, 1000 milligrams and 250 ml of normal saline.
Slowly. You give it over 20 minutes or 30 minutes. You can give it slowly, and thereby you can give one or two injections, and with that you have completely covered. So when do you give the IV, Lakshmi?
When there is intolerance to oral iron or non-compliance, when there is malabsorption, or in cases of severe anemia, nearing term. And in case of thalassemias or hemoglobin.
No, you should, that is the contraindication actually. You should not, so you should be very sure about your diagnosis. It is the other way around. No, not, we should not give it in any thalassemias, because you will have iron toxicity. And before you give an IV prep, you should actually stop the oral for about 24 to 48 hours, because
the receptors
will get choked to the oral iron, and what you give will be the free form of iron producing its toxicity. Do you understand? And then when do you give blood?
Very severe form of anemia at any period of gestation.
So less than 4 grams at any period of gestation. Then
severe form
after 36 weeks of pregnancy. Then
in labor,
when there's an ongoing bleed. And when the patient has got a hemoglobinopathy, you may have to give. And what we give is normally Paxil. And how much does it raise hemoglobin by?
One gram.
Yeah. So parenteral iron and oral iron will increase hemoglobin by
0.8 to 1 gram
per week. And this will increase, blood will increase
one,
it by?
One unit by one gram
or 3% of hematocrit. And it will take about 48 to 72 hours for you to see the change in the hemoglobin after having given blood, okay? Mm-hmm. Now, how do you manage them in labor?
Monitoring in the first stage.
Yes.
Pulse rate and respiratory rate should be monitored. Especially to rule out failure. We have to restrict her fluid intake. In very severe
cases. We don't have to really restrict. No, there is no need to restrict fluid intake.
Keep her adequately hydrated.
Should keep her adequately hydrated. Yes.
Monitor her vitals, pulse rate, respiratory rate, blood pressure.
Blood pressure.
Also, continuous fetal monitoring.
Yes, continuous uterine contraction should be monitored. Continuous fetal monitoring should be done.
Adequate analgesia.
Epidurals can be given. Can we keep a partogram?
Yes.
Partogram can be maintained. And then
cross-match blood can be made available.
Yes, blood can be made available and kept ready if the patient is thin. Then what will you do?
In the second stage?
Second stage. So basically most of them enter into labor normally. You don't have to induce them. They're always going to spontaneous labor because there's a subclinical hypoxia. So they will often get into labor on their own. And then you need only manage the first stage. Second stage, what do you do, Lakshmi?
If needed, we can cut short the second stage with either forceps or vacuum. And most important is
don't allow it to strain too much. That's the only thing, okay? Yeah, it will be a load on the heart of a person who's already going in for a decompensation, the very severe anemia, right? Then?
Active management of third stage has to be done with oxytocin, uterine massage and controlled cord traction.
What do you give oxytocin? Just tell us. How do you give the oxytocin?
10 milligrams IM.
10 international units IM. IM.
5 international units.
1%?
5 international units and 5 ml of...
10 units. When you give it at the delivery of anterior shoulder or within
1 minute
of delivery of the baby. Yes.
5 units and 5 ml of normal saline over 5 seconds IV.
5 seconds slowly IV. So no harm in you giving both. You can give IM and IV if required, but IM is mandatory. IV will give you the immediate level so that she will not tolerate even the small amount of
blood loss,
right? And then what else will you do?
Any evidence of PPH should be promptly identified and
treated. Yes, so already if you've got, if at all, but please remember one thing, there should be no load on the heart because she can go in for a failure. If there is, not this patient, if there's a very severe degree of anemia, they can go in for a failure. And what is the first way to identify the patient has gone into failure?
Tachycardia
more than
100 beats per minute,
or when you find a
respiratory
rate more than 24 beats per minute, a raised JVP, basal Krebs, all that will tell you that the patient is going in for a failure. So at that time, be very careful. Don't give whole blood. We always want to give only packed cells. If at all you want to give to reduce the load on the heart, you can also give, diuretics. Okay. And then after that, you have to monitor the
fourth stage very carefully.
See that, you know, many times, what is one thing which you have to give for a patient with severe anemia?
Antibiotics
should be given.
Thromboprophylaxis
should be given. Early mobilization. Do you understand? All that should be taken care of. And what else will you advise them?
Oral iron should be continued during the postpartum period.
So what is the recommendation of WHO and the government of India, you said?
60 milligram of elemental iron with 400 microgram of folic acid for at least 6 months in the second and third trimester and continued for 3 months postpartum.
In areas of more prevalence, of 40% prevalence, this is a WHO's recommendation. And the government of India, Ministry of Health is?
100 milligram of elemental iron with 500 microgram folic acid for at least
100 days. 100 days in the second half of pregnancy is what is recommended. But what you should recommend is see that you give the patient adequate amount of iron through the entire lactation period. And the other advice which you will give is, Aishwarya?
Contraception.
Contraception should be advised. What contraception will you give?
Progesterone only pills.
We give it because we want to promote lactation. We can go in for progesterone only pills.
Second, Depo-Medroxyprogesterone or Implanon.
All that can be given in the immediate postpartum. And if it is not a very severe anemia, you can do anything. You can give her other forms of contraception also if required, like low dose oral contraceptive pills or even an IUCD. There is no harm. The best is adequate spacing between pregnancies. And once she has completed her family, you go in for
sterilization.
A permanent method of sterilization. Okay. So that is what is very important. And now in this patient, now she goes through the first stage, second stage, third stage. And do you think she's going to have any problem, this particular patient of yours?
She will just sail through because
9.4 was her hemoglobin. And so you just correct it. You don't have to give any components. You don't have to give any blood or RBCs. Just see that she reduces her blood loss in the third stage of labor. And you take her through an adequate fourth stage and see that she's given iron through the post during her lactation period. Okay, that's all that she will require. And then you advise her on contraception so that she doesn't become pregnant too fast. The ideal spacing between two babies would be around
2 years.
That will be the ideal. And once she has completed her family, then you can go in for a permanent method of sterilization. Right. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you.